Raising up the lions. If Christ is your Lord, then it means that you live to serve Him and that you allow God to fully have His way with you. If you want to be raised up as a functioning heir, glorified son, victorious king, serving priest, and a bride of Christ in the kingdom of Yahweh, the Almighty God, then you must first allow yourself to be fully conquered by Him. Like the Lord said to me, a king can only reign over that which he has fully conquered. It should be common sense to us. He's the Savior of most, but the Lord of very few. The uncircumcised heart, and I want to explain to you that what the uncircumcised heart is. The Spirit of God put that term in the Bible, uncircumcision. It's to do with the progressive cutting away of that which is wrong, lustful, sinful, devilish, and sensual, and fallen, and corrupt in us. It's the pruning of the Father. It's the cutting asunder of the word of Hebrews 4:12 between spirit, soul, joints, and marrow. It's a stripping away of that which stands between you and God, that blocks you from being wholly devoted to God, the circumcision. An uncircumcised heart and fallen, unrenewed, natural, corrupt mind. It belongs to the order of this fallen world. The natural, corrupt mind of the fleshly, carnal, sinful man is selfish by nature and self-centered and driven by self-desire and wants everything to go its way, or else it becomes offended. The fleshly natural man has created a false Christ. Many think that God is their genie on command. He's there to serve them in their dreams, desires, and earthly purposes and agendas. They live with the mentality, let my kingdom come and let my will be done. They know not what true surrender is. They understand not that we have been commanded by God to lay down our rebellious will, which are completely contrary to the will of the Father. And what it means to follow Christ through Gethsemane by partaking of the cup of self-denial. Most don't understand the anguish of the road of kingdom destiny, which is only found in the way of the cross, by which you discover eternal reward, esteem, and honor from the Father. So many are resisting being discipled by Christ and being disciplined by the prunings of the Father to make them fruitful within His kingdom, to reap the reward of the crown of the overcomer and a place with Christ in His throne. And people need to understand, to be a saved person and to be a disciple of Christ is worlds apart. It's two very different things. Because most camp on the level of salvation. They've never taken up the cross in denial of self, to truly lay themselves down for the sake of the kingdom. To become one with God in vision, desire, and purpose. Many think God's love pampers the flesh and condones sin, and that grace is a license to live as they please, because God understands and wants them to be happy. They understand nothing about regeneration and transformation through brokenness And Holy Spirit wrought out repentance unto holiness and godliness, which is Christ-likeness. Such is the reality and condition of many people who call themselves Christians. This generation needs to heed the admonitions of the Spirit and God's outcries through His prophets. We are called to stand out for that which is true and eternal, for all else is sinking sand. People have itchy ears to listen to and be fascinated by new, exciting, seductive things. They give up the eternal things of infinite value in exchange for trinkets and baubles that sparkle and flash with iridescent, fluorescent and psychedelic colors. Lucifer tempted Eve with things that sounded and looked good, exciting and reasonable. It's the same today. But counterfeit shining baubles and trinkets only have value in people's minds because they look as if they have value and beauty. The carnal man likes to be entertained, and Satan will do everything in his power to seduce people away from being sold out and purely devoted to Christ, and to invest in the eternal reality awaiting us all and which is inescapable. 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive the things done through the body according to that which he has done, whether good or bad. What will your personal account be like when you stand before Christ in the judgment? Have you considered how serious this is? Did you live for the glory and exaltation and praise of yourself, or did you surrender all of yourself to God so He may have His way with you and in your life and be glorified through you? Like the Father spoke to me out of eternity with a voice that burned like fire through my being after a year kingdom exploit in the year 2011, and He declared, there are no adequate words that can articulate the majestic honor and glory that permeates a life that was sacrificed so that the God of wonders might be glorified. It has eternal consequences that only eternity will tell. Have you answered the upward call of God in Christ, as was instructed and commanded in Philippians chapter 2? The following shall be the standard by which all of us shall be judged. This is the pattern that must be worked out in the life of every disciple and follower of Jesus Christ. Your attitude and outcry to God must be, Father, work out the pattern and the example of your Son in my life by the power and inspiration of the Holy Spirit. We read in, from verse 2, so by whatever appeal to you there is in our mutual dwelling in Christ, by whatever strengthening and consoling and encouraging our relationship in Him affords, by whatever persuasive incentive there is in love, by whatever participation in the Holy Spirit we share, and by whatever depth of affection and compassionate sympathy, fill up and complete my joy by living in harmony and being of the same mind, one in purpose, having the same love, being in full accord and of one harmonious mind and intention. Do nothing from factional motives, through contentiousness, strife, selfishness, or for unworthy ends, or prompted by conceit, vanity, empty arrogance. Instead of the true, in the true spirit of humility, lowliness of mind, let each regard the others as better than and superior to himself, thinking more highly of one another than you do of yourselves. Let each of you esteem and look upon and be concerned not merely for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Let this mind and attitude and purpose and let this same attitude, purpose, and humble mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Let him be your example in humility and service and love and obedience to the Father, who although being essentially one with God and in form of God, possessing the fullness of the attribute which makes God God, did not think this equality with God was a thing to be eagerly grasped or retained, but stripped himself of all privileges and rightful dignity, so as to assume the guise of a servant slave, in that he became like men and was born a human being. And after he had appeared in human form, he abased and humbled himself still further, and carried his obedience to the extreme of death, even the death of the cross. And we are called to follow in his footsteps. This is what Jesus meant in John 15. No greater love is a man than to lay down his life for his friends. Therefore, because he stooped so low, God has highly exalted him and has freely bestowed on him the name that is above every name. This is the way to honor in the kingdom of Yahweh. There's no other way. You're not going to sidestep the cross and expect to be glorified with Christ, to receive the honor of sonship manifested, mature sonship. Therefore, my dear ones, as you have always obeyed my instructions, so now, with the enthusiasm you would show in my presence, but much more because I'm absent, work out, cultivate, carry out the goal, and fully complete your own salvation with reverence and awe and trembling, self-distrust, with serious caution, tenderness of conscience, watchfulness against temptation, timidly shrinking from whatever might offend God and discredit the name of Christ. Not in your own strength, for it is God who is all the while effectually at work in you, energizing and creating in you the power and desire both to will and to work for his good pleasure and satisfaction and delight. And this is a powerful scripture that can be prayed over your life. Father, I ask daily that you keep on energizing me and creating in me the power and desire to do your will. Understand that you must first fulfill the pattern of the Lamb, which is the way of the cross, through sacrificial obedience in agreement with the scripture which is read, before you can be placed with Christ in his throne as a conquering king, which is the lion aspect of his life and ministry. You can't sidestep the cross. Jesus went through his cross, we have to go through our cross. Can't camp on the level of salvation as a baby Christian and expect to be placed in the seat of the overcomer as a functioning heir. Do we think God is less intelligent than man? The Spirit of God speaks to us through Jalil and Earls. Now have the seals been broken, now is the sealed book open. Hear now, my people, and I will show you the mystery of the seals as they relate to my end time purposes. The seals have a double fulfillment. One is the overall historical covering the period from the days of the increasing alignment of church with the powers of state in the 4th century until the end of the present age, and the other is the short-term end-time fulfillment. For I conform all things to the basic pattern of truth which is recorded in my word. Therefore, yea, and I will show you the seals and their fulfillment during the years that you are living in the time, in the end-time period of this present age. You shall note it was the Lion of the tribe of Judah who prevailed to open a seven-sealed book. Yet it was a lamb who took the book or scroll from the hand of him that sat on the throne and opened the seals thereof. What does this portray? It portrays the truth of Jesus' ministry as King Priest. As a priest, he is the Lamb of God who gave himself as the perfect sacrifice on the cross and ever lives to make intercession for the redeemed. As a king, he is the Lion of the tribe of Judah who reigns on the throne of David. Now, during this dispensation of redemption, his lamb ministry predominates. That is why he is seen as a lamb. But as the present age and dispensation draws to a close and the seals of judgment are opened to bring to an end the mystery of man, it is the lion ministry that begins to prevail, for Jesus the King begins to actively take over that which is rightfully his. He begins to exert the power and authority which was given to him after his resurrection in such a way as to completely eliminate the usurpation of Satan-controlled man and exercise his own right as king. It is during the end-time period of the seals and the trumpets that forces of judgment are set in motion so that man's civilization will utterly collapse, and thus it becomes fulfilled that the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign for the eons. We are the kingdom that comes to take over. And this was prophesied in Daniel 2. The stone that was cut out of a mountain that came to crush Satan's empire. The lion nature of Jesus' ruling authority must be made manifest, and this begins to prevail as the seals are opened, but it does not completely predominate until all rival rule and authority has been put down. First, the Islam ministry of redemption must be completely fulfilled for the present age, even though his lion ministry of kingship begins to come to the fore. This, my people, must also be the pattern in your own lives. First, you must fulfill the pattern of the lamb. You must learn submission, meekness, sacrifice, and willingness to hear and follow and obey the voice of the shepherd, or you will never enter the lion ministry of joint rulership with Christ. You cannot sidestep the cross. And you cannot just be saved by the cross and camp out on the level of salvation. We have to move on to maturity and answer the upward call of God through the cross unto sonship. The Spirit of God says, if you are fully yielded and prepared as a lamb, then you shall come forth in that end-time ministry of power, boldness, and authority, which is symbolized by the lion. The fact that the Lion of the tribe of Judah has begun to exercise his prerogatives will be manifested on the earth not only by judgments upon man's civilization, but also by the bringing forth of a people who shall enter into spiritual realms of ruling with Christ that no people ever experienced before, and which shall cause a spiritual shaking and a revival unprecedented in human history. Great shall be the glory, power, and dominion which shall be shown forth by a people who have first come into the fullness of the lamb nature of full submission, and then are moved into the lion ministry of the Lord's end-time glorious church. I bless you with this wonderful word in Jesus' name.